put your feet on that. You know, one thing I found out a long time ago is when somebody of authority opens the door for you to come into their realm, they've given you place to affect that spiritually. I had a word for a woman back in Wisconsin one time. I said, I see you standing on a school ground, looking across the school ground, and God's showing you children, showing you what's going on in their life, and to have you pray for them and intercede for them. I said, what do you do for a living? She says, I work at a school. So what God was saying is, I want you to be salt and light in that school. You may be hindered by some natural rules, but you're not. You, when you put your foot on that soil, you're there in the name of the Lord.
Yes.
And you can pray and do the things, whether you ever talk to anybody or not. So anyway, this is coming up. We're gonna meet shortly with the principal and all that and find out, you know, what doors are open for us. And if you'd like to participate in this, we're not talking about a 7 or 5 day a week thing. We're just talking about maybe an hour or two a week serving our community, ministering to our community. But that's going to be coming up, so just be in prayer about that. Amen?
Yes. Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, grab your Bible this morning. Turn over to the book of Psalms, or as one presidential candidate put it, the book of Plasms. That one got me, I have to. I remember hearing one minister years ago, his mother was praying for him. If your mother's praying for you, you might as well just give up, right? And he was fighting, you know, and he finally one day, they were after him about getting a job. He was just laying around being lazy. And so he said, well, maybe this Bible will help me some way. So he said he opened the Bible and he opened it to the book of Job. He said, man, I can't even open the Bible without somebody telling me to get a job. What a job. Praise God. Thank you, Father. Your presence is so good. Oh, hallelujah. Did you sense that?
Yes, amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Psalm 117. Did I say that?
Yes.
Psalm 117. Won't go into a lot of details about it, except just to say that the Lord, we are in a time, a season. Well, let me back up a couple of steps. You've heard me say this before, but it's always good to, I think, just kind of bring it out. Over in the book of Samuel, we won't turn there, but in Samuel, Samuel came on the scene as a small child into an environment that was completely shut down spiritually. Should have been full of the blessing and revelation of God. The scriptures went on to say there, if you read the first couple of chapters of 1 Samuel, it talks about how there was no open vision. Open vision. See, God isn't a God that just talked about what happened way back and way out in the future. He's a God that talks about what's going on now.
Yes.
And we are to be connected with Him. Jesus told His disciples, when I go to heaven and pour out the Spirit on you, He's going to show you things that are coming up. Amen. Why? So you can go with Him.
Yeah.
You can go with God's plan.
Right.
You know, you can be a Spirit-filled, tongue-talking, devil-chasing Christian and still be deceived by the devil.
Yeah.
Sure.
And it's because you don't know what spiritual season you're in. The devil is a deceiver, folks. He always works in the earth to make it look like the opposite of the way God sees it. Amen? It's the old thing with David. All the whole army and king of Israel said, Goliath's too big to hit. David came down there, looked at him through the eyes of God, and said, oh no, God gave me a big target. He's too big to miss. Because he understood. He understood he had the king's anointing, number one. The rule and reign, number two. He understood that giant was standing on the land of Judah and didn't have a right to be there. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. When you see things through God's eyes, and of course, Jesus, we've talked about before, how He rebuked the Pharisees because they didn't understand. He said, you can look at the sky, tell me whether it's going to rain tomorrow or not, but He said, you can't discern the signs of the times. What signs? The Scripture being fulfilled. If they would have really understood the Old Testament, by the Holy Spirit teaching them, because He's the author of the book, When Jesus showed up, they would have went, oh, there he is. But they had this man-made religious idea about the Messiah and the King Messiah, and here's what he's going to do, and here's how he's going to come. And so here they were, fighting not only the move of God, but fighting God himself standing there on two legs.
Right. Amen.
Yes. Amen. Amen. I don't want to be like that.
Amen.
I don't want to fight what God's doing.
Amen.
And when God, you know, God's progressive. He's going to do things in ways that human minds sometimes don't comprehend. Usually the biggest enemy to the fresh new move of God in the earth is the old move.
That's right.
We get used to doing things a certain way. I'm not talking about unscriptural things. God never departs from his word.
Right.
But we're so quick many times to judge things based on what we see in our own opinion. The smarter I get, the dumber I get.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The more I understand the things of God, the more I realize that, boy, there's a lot more I sure don't understand here.
Right.
If you ever quit being taught, you're going to end up fighting against God, I guarantee you.
Yeah.
Every person that has that know-it-all spirit will fight God. And then there's always two things going on usually. You know, Paul's ministry, he was an apostle, he was called to go and establish churches, establish the kingdom of God, and the things that he was called to do, write 3/4 of the New Testament, all those things he was anointed to do. But the devil, of course, knew that was what was on his life and what he was doing. So the enemy, you know, it's like we say, wherever he would go, he'd have a revival and a riot.
Yeah.
But most people look at the riot and judge, try to judge what's going on spiritually. Now, if you see it through God's eyes in the right way, if you see the enemy resisting it, then you know it's probably of God.
Yeah.
But don't be real quick to judge.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Go to the Holy Spirit. Go to the Word. Let him tell you what he's saying.
Yeah.
The Lord began to talk to me about some things about this year. And actually, this goes several years back as I would pray, because he started talking to me in 2008 about something new coming and fresh in our nation and all of this. And I had a lot of lessons to learn. I'm still learning and so forth. But as the last couple of years ago, I began to ask him about certain things. And he kept drawing me back to the year 2017. That things were going to really start happening, shifting, manifesting in 2017. I didn't know all was going to go on with the election and all the different things that are going on. And of course, the upheaval and all that's happening right now. But Psalm 117 would just jumped out at me. And then this last week, I was listening to a prophet of God preach, and he had said the same thing that the Lord had shown me, that Psalm 117 was a psalm for us to operate in right now in this spiritual season we're in. And I was going to minister on this morning. I come in here, and all of the psalms, all of the choruses that they had chosen went right down that pathway. Went right down the same pathway. Look, it's a 2-verse psalm. Oh, praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise him, all ye people. For his merciful kindness is great toward us, and the truth of the Lord endures forever. What was that first chorus we sang?
Thank you, Lord.
The Lord is good, and his mercies are forever. Amen?
Yep.
Praise you, the Lord. Now, this first word, praise, in verse 1, it's a word that, it's halal. It means to shine, to boast, to rave, to celebrate.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, I don't want to, Lord, help me not to get bogged down in details today. In Israel's 7-cycle feasts, you know, the 7-feast cycle they had every year under the Old Testament, it was a circle, it was a cycle that when they honored God in those feasts and did what they were supposed to do toward the Lord from their heart and then in the doing of those feasts, that God kept them in a cycle of blessing.
Yes.
If you study the Old Testament, you'll find that when they started breaking that cycle, not so much the doing of the natural part of it, but in their hearts. Isaiah 58 is a great chapter about that. The prophet, God tells the prophet, lift up your voice like a trumpet and tell the people that they're playing games with me, is the way I would put it. They are going through the motions of the feast, but their heart's not in it.
Yeah.
They're not doing it with the right heart.
Good.
Amen?
Yeah.
Jesus' teachings, you look at his teachings, most of them had to do with heart condition.
Yep.
Spiritual condition. He doesn't get hung up on as many things as we get done. We're always looking at the outward appearance. He's looking at what's going on in the heart.
Yes.
Amen?
Right.
That's why he tells us to judge ourselves.
Right.
Not judge yourself, well, did I say as many prayers as I should have, or did I give God enough time? Judge your heart attitude. Is your heart attitude, are you submitted to him?
Right.
Have you given your life to him?
Amen.
Do you continually give your life to him?
Yes.
When you mess up as a human, do you just let it go and just develop an attitude or a root of bitterness, or do you give back to him your heart once again and humble yourself?
Thank you, Lord.
See, he says if you'll humble yourself, I'll lift you up.
Yes.
But if you're going to try to lift yourself up, you'll be in pride, and the Bible says pride comes before a boom. Amen? So it's that heart that he says, judge your heart. See, I know if I'm copping an attitude toward people or God. I know if I'm not honoring God or myself even. Some people don't honor themselves. The devil's got them in this big guilt trip in their mind, religious guilt trip that's usually based out of trying to obtain something through human works which can't be obtained. I'm not saying you don't do good works. I'm not saying you shouldn't be faithful. But the basis of your relationship is what's going on in here. Your honest, open relationship with God in humility saying, you're God and I'm not.
Right.
Teach me. Help me. Show me. You know, when David committed adultery with Bathsheba, got her pregnant, and then he was afraid he was going to be exposed, and he worked things around to where her husband was put out in the front of the battle and killed and so forth. He went on for about 9 months, I think it was, not dealing with that. David, the man after God's own heart.
Yes.
Finally, God sent a prophet to him. And the prophet put his big bony prophetic finger in his face, I'm sure. And told him an illustrated story about a man who was stealing sheep, and hurting sheep. And David got all self-righteous and fired up and revengeful. Oh, man, you know. And the prophet looked at him and said, you're that man.
Right.
See, sometimes God sends people to you to slap you in the face by the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
I was reading the scripture yesterday. It says the wounds of a friend are precious. Because a friend will only wound you in a right way.
Amen.
They'll tell you the truth you don't want to hear because they don't want to see you, the enemy, take you down.
Amen.
Now, I'm not talking about, you know, Captain Correction.
Right.
Remember the commercials, Captain Obvious? You guys see those words? Well, there's people in the church that are Captain Correction, you know. They're so busy watching what everybody else is doing or not doing. But they're not watching what they're doing or not doing.
Right.
And they're going to correct you. Well, I got news for you. You're not the father of the family.
Right.
When my sons are growing up and they get into it, I wouldn't let them correct each other. I'd tell them, I'm the father. You got a problem with him, you come to me.
Yeah.
And we'll deal with it.
Amen.
So the same thing with God. Amen?
Amen.
But if a friend sees you going off on a path where you're going to get hurt, they may tell you, hey, you're wrong.
Right.
Right.
Amen? Your friend.
Yes.
Lord.
Not Captain Correction.
Right.
Lord, help me not get off on rabbit trails today. Praise the Lord, all you nations. Praise Him. Now that word, praise, is a different word, that second word. It means to properly address with a loud tone.
Okay.
It has an element of honor in it. The other one just basically means to celebrate. Now, I kind of got off track away from the seven feasts I was talking about. The last feast of the year was called the Feast of Tabernacles. Everybody say Feast of Tabernacles. Feast of Tabernacles on the Jewish calendar usually takes place in like September, October on our calendar because they have a lunar calendar. We have a solar calendar. And so it changes every year on our calendar, that kind of thing. But what they would do during this, the seven, actually 8 day, the last day, the eighth day, was the great day of the feast. That's the one in John 7, I believe it is, where Jesus, spoke out and said, if you want water, come to me, and talking about the Holy Ghost. But anyway, That feast, the Feast of Tabernacles, was a feast where they made these booths. They call them sukkahs.
Yes.
They're a booth, a little temporary kind of a lean-to booth-looking thing. And they would actually sleep in those booths every night to remind them that while their relatives, while the people that came before them were in the wilderness, God took care of them. Where they had no water, no food, no anything, God took complete, total care of them for 40 years.
Yes.
What's the message in that? God is the source.
Yes.
Now, it came at the end of the harvest season, where harvest was stacked up all around them, where prosperity and blessing was around them, which would have been the temptation to say, well, you know, to start leaning on that, start leaning on, you know, the harvest and making that your source. And what's going on in the nation, your source. See, that's why America has gotten in the mess it's in, is because we've got too many things to lean on.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
Now, thank God for the good things God's given us, doctors and the abundance of food and all that. But that is not God. That's the provision of God.
Right.
So God told them every year, I want you to go out here and just get your mind straightened out here. That over there is my blessing on you, just like I took care of your relatives out in the desert. But this feast, this festival, was a seven-day praise party.
Woo!
Seven-day praise party. That's what it was. Look it up. Study it. They would go in there, and they took the rags or the cloth from the old priestly garments that were wore out, and they put them in these big torch-like things in the temple, and they would light these things up at night, and they would get in there, and they would just celebrate God and praise Him. What were they doing? They were thanking Him for the blessing that He'd already put on them that last year.
Yes.
They were thanking Him for being God. They were thanking Him that He came through for them again.
Yes.
They were thanking Him that He was God and that He had done what He, you know, He had shifted them into a new year, and He blessed them in this past year.
Yes.
Now, there's been a major shift in the spirit. If you knew what season you're in right now, if you knew the kairos, as it says in the Greek in the New Testament, that's what Jesus told those Pharisees. He says, you don't know the signs of the times. That word times is the Greek word kairos, which means that which time gives you the opportunity to do. It's, you know, it's here's time. The Bible talks in Ephesians about time. The days are evil. All you got to do for evil days is just breathe air and take up space and ignore God. And the enemy will deceive you, and he'll come in, and he'll turn your days into evil somehow. Because that's the flow ever since Adam and Eve sinned. That's what's going on. The God of this world, that's where it's at. But if you will get with God and find out what He wants to do and will do and maybe already has done in the time you're in right now, what season it is with Him, and react accordingly by faith, then what God wants to do, what God is doing, will come upon your life and manifest itself in your world.
Yes.
The just shall live by faith.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Faith. Trust. Trust in what? Trust in what God has said and saying and doing, not what it looks like to you out here in the natural realm. How many of you are getting this today? See, the enemy wants to keep us looking this way. What's going on? 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 Oh, I heard the news commentator say this. Well, I don't know. I think that. Well, this person said that. Doesn't matter. What does God say?
Amen.
What's the Holy Ghost saying? Well, I don't know, Pastor, what the Holy Ghost is saying. I'm going to give you a super deep spiritual secret. Ask Him. I'm serious. We've made this thing way too hard. We've got this, you know, and God is holy, God is all-powerful, God is beyond description. I understand that, I get that, but He's also... That's why He sent Jesus to our level to be able to communicate with us. We have a great high priest who has suffered every kind of temptation and pressure and sin and whatever. We have suffered. He became sin on the cross. All the weight of all that came on Him. All the experience of all that came on Him. So He understands. He gets it. He gets it more than you get it. And I get it. And so the Holy Spirit is our communication line between us and Him. And if we will ask the Holy Spirit, treat Him like He's real.
Yes.
Treat Him like He is there.
Amen.
Amen. He will show you. He will reveal to you. You may not even believe what He says at first because it doesn't make sense to you. But if you'll take what He shows you, you'll get in the Word, you'll begin to pursue God, you'll begin to press into these things, then you're going to find that that prophetic puzzle piece He gave you, that Word, that understanding, all of a sudden other pieces are going to fall into place, and you're going to see a picture of what God's saying, and you're going to be able to live your life by that and not have the days become evil in your life. God never intended for you and I to stress out and worry our way through life.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm not saying fear won't come. It comes to me every day.
Yes.
The spirit of fear will come at you every day.
Yes.
He has to. The only way the devil can control your life is through deception. He has no weapons that can dominate you. He has absolutely no right in your life whatsoever. He was cut off by the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
So the only way He can get you, just like with Adam and Eve, they were had God's life and nature in them. They were God's family. They were there. They were protected. They were blessed. The only way He can get them is to talk them into believing something that wasn't true.
Right.
Amen.
Spirit of fear came to Eve. Half God said.
Right.
When you hear that kind of nonsense, you know it's the devil.
Right.
Amen. Questioning the Word of God. Questioning what God said. Half God said. And then He goes on and says, well, God knows that if you eat of this, you'll be like... In other words, God's holding out on you. You really can't trust Him. He's afraid you're going to be on His level. Fear. Somehow there was that fear. Oh, man, I'm going to do this, or I'm going to, it's not going to work out for me somehow.
Come on.
That's a lying devil.
That's right. Amen.
And people sitting here this morning that think it's not going to work out for you, I'm telling you, it is going to work out for you. If you'll give your life to God and listen to Him and pursue God, and spend at least as much time pursuing Him as you do trying to figure it out in your own little pea brain up here.
Amen.
He'll fill you with revelation and light. He'll begin to show you things. And now listen, don't try to, you're not going to get understand it up here. You're not going to walk with God up here. God will give you the mind of Christ. He will show you His truth. You will understand them in your mind. But He's going to give you something to do that's the next step on your journey. And you don't even know where you're going, so just do what He shows you to do.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
It might be something as simple as actually going to church.
Yeah.
Well, I don't need church. I don't see you going to hear all this stuff. I don't need to go to a local church or be a Christian.
Yeah.
I don't need to go in a house when it's 50 below outside, has a fire inside it, to be a human either.
Right.
But I'm going to freeze to death if I don't.
Right.
It's not about a preacher. It's not about... It's about us, a corporate group of people that, by the way, if you read 1 Corinthians chapter 12, we are connected to one another. We're a corporate body. One of the great truths about a body is every member of that body is interdependent on the other members of the body for its survival. I've been pastoring over 30 years. I've watched the renegade lone wolf Christian type.
Yeah.
Oh, there ain't no church, They go out, the devil eats them, man.
Yeah.
The wolf is waiting for that sheep that drifts away.
Yeah.
I'm not telling you to go to this church. Matter of fact, if you're not supposed to be in this church, I don't want you in this church. Because you're going to be out of place, you're not going to like me, and I'm probably going to get sideways with you sooner or later.
Yeah.
Over something. Because you're in the wrong place.
Right.
But one thing I found out about God is, He takes us where we need to be, not where we want to be.
Right.
He did that to me when I opened my mouth at 29 and said, I'll do whatever You tell me to do, Lord. I'll follow whatever You tell me to do, even if I don't understand it. First thing He did was ask me to do something I didn't understand. But God knows what He's doing.
Yeah.
This is a year of praise. Verse 2, His merciful kindness is great toward us. We are in a season right now where God has shifted. I don't have time to go into all the details of the things He showed me, like what He did on the Day of Atonement. He showed me how that he had, that the prayers of the saints had come forth to him, and he had released on our nation the blood of Jesus. Now listen, the blood of Jesus, don't just think of red liquid, you know, flowing on the ground.
Right.
There's life in that blood. The DNA of God is in that blood.
Amen.
That was life being given for a life. Your life. And now, you are born again. He who knew no sin was made to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God. Larry Huggins preached that wonderful sermon that one time when he was here, out of John 3:16, was it? The God's only begotten, that word begotten is the word genome in the Greek. Jesus had the genome, he had the nature of God in him. And when he gave his life and went to heaven, he then caused us to receive that same nature in life in our spirit. You're a born-again child of God. You've been born from above. You're not, you know, overhauled with some new parts so that you can function a little better. You're a brand new man. You're a new created creature in Christ. Yes, you still have flesh. Yes, your mind's not totally renewed. But spiritually, you're made in his image and likeness again, like Adam and Eve were. You're born again. And so the Holy Spirit that dwells in your spirit is going to communicate to you, and that blood that's on the mercy seat in heaven. The mercy seat. The mercy seat.
Yes.
How many of you remember the Old Testament? They had to build the Ark of the Covenant, put it in the Holy of Holies. They put certain things in the Ark. They put Aaron's rod that budded, which was symbolic of the authority of the priesthood at that time. That was in the ark, or in the box in the Ark of the Covenant. There was a bowl of manna, God's provision from heaven. And of course, we can go into that, talk about that, and preach on that for a couple of years probably. And then there was a copy of the law. Now, the priesthood of Aaron wasn't good enough to be a priest, good enough of a priesthood to get us in heaven. It could keep us in a place of blessing with God, that priesthood, if it was dealt with right and honored right. Amen. The manna was a temporary provision, a daily provision. Amen. And if you got a little greedy and tried to gather up too much because you didn't want to get out of bed the next day, it turned into worms. Right? Amen. Because, see, the wilderness was just the land of just enough. Amen. Just enough to keep you alive. Just enough for you to survive. Egypt was a land of not enough. Not enough brick, or not enough straw to make brick. You know, they were slaves. Not enough, not enough, not enough. They get out into the wilderness. It's a land of just enough. But God says, there's another place. And it's called the land of more than enough. So those items were put in that copy of the law. And the law, what did the law do? The law revealed that we couldn't keep it. We couldn't meet God's standard of perfection on our own. The priesthood through Aaron wasn't good enough to get us over the hump where we became children of God again.
Right.
It could keep us blessed if we were under that priesthood at that time.
Right.
And the manna was just, we were just surviving. You know, there's a lot of Christians that's where they live even now, is in the wilderness.
Yeah.
Well, I won't go that direction. But the land of more than enough. See, Jesus, his high priesthood, his priesthood, when he became that sacrifice for us, he became all of it. He was the lamb, he's the lion, he's the high priest, he's all of it. It's all in him.
Yes.
And when he went to the heavenly holy of holies, he told Mary when she was standing there after he rose from the dead, remember she was standing there weeping, thinking they'd stolen his body? She saw Jesus and thought he was a gardener that was taking care of the graveyard there. She went to him and said, "Where have you taken my Lord?" And Jesus turned and spoke to her, and he said her name, Mary. Let me tell you, when Jesus calls your name, it's different than somebody saying, "Hey, bub."
Amen.
Yes.
And he said to her, he said, you know, and she saw who it was. Now here's what he said, something a little strange. He said, "Don't touch me." Why? Because he was standing as the sanctified high priest. He had been sanctified and prepared. Rose from the dead He said, "For I have not yet ascended to my Father and your Father, my God and your God." In other words, I'm taking my blood up there before him and sprinkling it like the high priest did every year on the Holy of Holies, the Holy of Holies, the heavenly Holy of Holies, the mercy seat. And that blood, now it says in Hebrews chapter 12, is crying out continually. You look it up in the Greek, it means a continual voice. Speaking what? Mercy, 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 mercy. When God, the judge of all, we come before him, based on not our good works, but based on what Jesus did for us, and we throw ourselves on the mercy of the court. The Father has to make a judgment call. Does he judge based on the law? Does he judge based on perfect actions, perfect performance? Or does he judge based on the performance Jesus did on our behalf? Yes. And he's hearing over here out of the Holy of Holies. Mercy, mercy, mercy. Now mercy, the definition of the word mercy is loving kindness. You know, the scriptures say that mercy and truth have met together. I'm glad it's not just truth. Because there'd be some truth about my life I didn't want to talk about. I know you're holy and all that. But, right? Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness, what's right, and peace, shalom, have kissed each other.
Yes.
Why is the word kissed used there? Kiss was a covenant thing.
Yes.
You know, we see people still do this in the eastern part of the world. They kiss each other on the cheek.
Good.
It's saying, I'm in covenant with you. I give my life to you. I'm being sincere from my heart. You see people do this kind of thing too. What they're saying is, I'm coming to you wholeheartedly. I'm sincere.
Praise God.
Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. They're in covenant together. The Bible even says that when God was forced to judge, when he was forced to judge, he would remember mercy. When he was forced to judge Israel, finally, after they wouldn't listen to him and wouldn't heed him, and he finally said, the land is going to have its Sabbaths. You've ignored the Shemitah year every seventh year. You haven't obeyed me for 70 years, and now I'm taking you out of the land, and I'm going to give the land its rest. Because see, the land had to be blessed for them to be blessed.
Right.
That's a whole other story. But he pulled them out for 70 years and put them out of the land. But even in that judgment, he remembered mercy. He not only prophesied they were going to leave, made a judgment call, but he also prophesied, but you're going to come back.
Amen.
Yes. You're the comeback kid this morning.
Yes. Yes.
You may feel like you've done too much bad or somehow it's over for you. No, it's not.
Amen.
If you throw yourself on the mercy of the court, if you receive the mercy of God, and we have now, and I haven't really done probably a very good job of relating it, but we are now in a season where things have shifted spiritually. On our nation, on people. I'm hearing people tell me how that their life is being changed, how all of a sudden the potential of being out of their job and in something different or whatever, you know, out of where you were at living for years into a new house. It's just everything in the natural and in the spiritual is shifting and changing. What's happening right now, listen to me. Now, if you don't get any rest, just get this. What God is wanting to do is shift you into a position spiritually and naturally because we're getting ready to take off like a rocket. In the body of Christ, the glorious church is going to come forth. A tremendous revival is getting ready to hit this nation and hit this world. And God is taking people that have walked with him faithfully and positioning them so they can be a part of that, flow with that, and be blessed in that as it happens.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Every devil you stood against, every hard thing you've went through, everything that's come against you all these years, you're like Joseph. You got a word from God. And all of a sudden it looked like everything but what God said is going to happen in your life. You're going to be a man of authority, Joseph. Let me give you a couple of prophetic dreams here. You're going to be, you know, even your family's going to bow down to you. He shared that with them, and it didn't go over me. Brothers already didn't like him because he was daddy's favorite.
Yes.
All right? So what did they do? They wanted to kill him. The oldest brother says, wait a minute, you can't do that. Put him in a hole. Threw him in a pit. Sold him into slavery. But you know what? He needed to be in Egypt, didn't he? I heard Lance Wallenhouse say this, and it's so true. He said, every setback is a setup.
Amen.
Every time the devil attacked Joseph's life, he moved him closer to the throne. He was in Israel, and he needed to be in Egypt, because that's where he was going to rule. So the devil attacks him. God says, appreciate you doing that. We got him a little closer here now.
Amen.
And here he is, Potiphar's house. Potiphar's the general, the main general in Egypt. He's there and he's serving as a servant in the house. Gets falsely accused. Potiphar believed his wife instead of believing Joseph. Threw him in prison that he didn't deserve to be thrown in. But it was the king's prison.
Amen.
Where the people that hung around the king got put if they got in trouble.
Amen.
That was their timeout space. Amen? So every setback, the enemy would attack him with something, became a setup. You know why? Because he stayed with what God had said. The Bible says the word of the Lord tried him. I hear people say, well, I tried to do that faith stuff that doesn't work. No, it tried you and you didn't work.
That's it.
The Bible doesn't say the triers will be blessed. It says the doers. The doers. I don't know what to do. Well, just keep on doing.
Right.
The word. Not maybe not what you're doing over here.
Right.
But find out what God says and just keep believing that, saying that, walking in that.
Yeah.
Keep doing it.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
And so Joseph was positioned. You know, it's like a crown on a king. You know, it's kind of looks like this, right?
Yeah.
Joseph got a word from God. Got a dream. Praise God. Ooh, whoa, I'm going to be a man of authority in the pit.
Yeah,
got lifted up to be a servant in the house of Potiphar. Got prestige. Rubbing elbows with all the who's who in the Egypt zoo, you know. Next thing you know, in the prison. Then he goes up. That's how you form a crown.
Amen.
Your ups and downs are forming your crown.
Yeah.
Keep your eyes on God. He's going to get you there.
Thank you, Jesus.
You're going to have a suddenly. You're going to find yourself one day in the prison outhouse and find yourself in the penthouse before Pharaoh the next day running the nation.
Hallelujah.
I'm telling you, this is happening in our time right now for people. That the Bible says the faithful person will eventually abound in the blessings of God. And that blessing is not just you having a pile of money or a new car. Praise God. I don't think God cares whether you ride a donkey or drive a car. It's up to you. We get all hung up on that stuff. It's about the covenant blessing coming on you and your household and your generation.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. It goes down the line, my friend.
Yes.
Amen. The Bible even says that when Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek, which is a type of Jesus in his king and priest ministry, it says when he paid tithes to him, that Levi, way down the line, paid tithes as far as God was concerned. What you do here goes down the line. I'm standing here today because I've had faithful parents. I've had faithful people before me that have obeyed God. And they've stayed faithful to Him and went through what they've gone through. But they've stayed faithful to Him. And they were blessed people, and that blessing is coming down the line to me. And it's coming down the line to you. Well, I don't have anybody before me that's been faithful. Well, you can start it right now.
Yes.
Amen.
You can start it.
Amen.
You can be that solitary, as it says over there in Ecclesiastes, that's set in a family.
Lord.
That out of you, everybody gets blessed. Out of Joseph's obedience, when the time came where they were all going to starve to death, all 70 of them, God used him to bring salvation. And not only that, when they got to Egypt, they began to multiply and multiplied into an army of millions.
Yeah.
And came out of Egypt. That's the first time God calls his people an army. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now, what does that have to do with Psalm 117? I'm glad you asked. The devil knows that what comes out of our mouth, when we believe it in our heart and speak it out of our mouth, it happens in our life. Some Christians don't believe that, but Jesus believed it because he said it. The scriptures say death and life are in the power of the tongue. And he that loves it will eat the fruit thereof. In other words, if you love death, if you embrace death in your heart, the devil's always trying to create a death culture.
Yes.
He wants people to think death is cool.
Right.
It's cool to kill your children in abortion. That's a thing to do. It's cool to do something else, you know, or go kill somebody else, or, you know, be tough, be bad, be a gangster, kill somebody.
Right.
But what you do, what you sow, you will reap. The devil knows that. That's why he's always trying to create the death culture. God's about life.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now thank God for God's forgiveness. You know, if we've all participated in things where, at the very least, we have spoken death. Have you ever spoken a curse over somebody? Well, no, I'm not into that, Pastor. I'm not a witch. I'm not in the occult. Have you ever said, that no good so-and-so, I wish they would grow up?
Yeah.
You just cursed them.
Right here.
I've done it. I'm guilty. I'm not guilty now because I repented. I ask God to help me, to forgive me, to let his blood cleanse those words. I mean, if he'll forgive other sins, he'll forgive that one, won't he? But see, during a time like right now, what's happening? What's coming out of the news media? What's happening in the street? What's happening when, I mean, people that have been friends for 30 years get in a conversation about some politics or something, next thing you know, they're mad enough to fight. What's going on? The enemy is absolutely desperate. He knows the shift has happened, and so he's trying to curse it. He's trying to get you. Now listen, it's not about you agreeing with the devil and saying what he's saying. He's trying to get you to get an unforgiveness,
right,
and animosity and hatred. Come on.
Right.
And start saying those words of cursing. The Bible says that we are not to render cursing for cursing, but contrarywise, blessing.
Yes.
Knowing that we are to receive a blessing.
Amen.
When somebody curses you, if you bless them, you are sowing seed and you will have a harvest of blessing. But if the devil can get you into the cursing game where you're attacking each other and you're holding unforgiveness in your heart toward each other and you're putting each other, you're agreeing with the devil's rhetoric, then the devil has killed two birds with one stone. Now the Lord showed me this about this psalm. He said, this is a year. 2017 is a year for us to celebrate him, rave about him, just like that time of celebration at the Feast of Tabernacles, where they would praise and magnify and glorify him. At the end of that celebration, they were to be in a position where they were refocused on him being the source, and that he was the one that did all of this, and he got the offering of thanksgiving, the sacrifice of thanksgiving. He got honored in it, and then on the eighth day, the great day of the feast, they would do something a little different. They would go down to the little stream there in Jerusalem. I forget the name of it right now. The priests would go down there and they would take a vessel and they would fill it full of the living waters. Flowing waters were living waters. Aren't you glad we have a river in us, not a pond?
Amen.
Amen. We don't want no pond scum growing in us. Amen.
Amen.
And they would take this vessel and they would pour it on the altar. And that eighth day, they had all these different fruits and different, all these things that they had were symbolic. And they were still praising and celebrating, but they were also praying for God, because that was the end of the year as far as they were concerned. That was the end of that cycle anyway. The end of the year came actually before that. But it was the end of that cycle, and God, they were praying for God to bless them again through the next year. So Jesus goes to this feast, and they're doing this on the eighth day. The great day of the feast is called. And he pipes up and yells out, if you want water, come to me and drink. Out of your belly, your spirit will flow rivers of living water. In other words, he was trying to help them transition from Old Testament understanding of just natural water and blessing falling into a place where the rains of heaven, where the glory of heaven. Deuteronomy 11:11 says that the land that they went into was not like Egypt, where you had to irrigate your crops out of the Nile River and use your foot. They had a contraption that you would kind of like a treadmill, or not a treadmill, but a bicycle type thing, where it would pump the water out of the river into the crops. He said, No. We're going to a place where heaven blesses the land, where the rains of heaven, it's a land of hills and valleys, and where the rains of heaven bless.
Yes.
So Jesus was telling them ahead of time, the Holy Spirit's going to be poured out, and if you'll receive Him, if you'll come to me and get saved and receive Him, then there's going to be a rain and a blessing coming from heaven that's going to flow out of you. The river's going to flow out of you.
Yeah.
Well, God is accelerating that river, I believe, my personal opinion, whatever. That this year, that what we've had in our state is a sign to us that things have shifted and that now the rivers of living water are available to us.
Amen. Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Now, how do you get in the river? How do you get the river to flow out of you? Verse 2. His merciful kindness is great toward us, and His truth endures forever. Praise ye the Lord.
Amen.
Don't get caught up in the demonic rhetoric.
Come on.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Go into the tape ministry. How many of you remember cassette tapes? Yeah. Anybody in here remember that? That's way out of date now, isn't it? We used to say, go into the tape ministry. Get some duct tape and put it over your mouth. David said, Lord, put a guard, put a sentry over my mouth.
Yes.
Well, we've got one. His name is the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And He will tell you when you're starting to go into a place. Now, why is that so important? Because we're in a time where God has to come in and do this. Amen? Psalm 22 says what? God inhabits. That means, that word inhabit means He comes into and settles down and He begins to rule and reign. See, all that has to happen for everything that you do in your life is just for God to just show up and sit on His throne.
Thank you, Lord.
It's all that has to happen. In His presence is fullness of joy.
Yes.
In His presence, the devil, you don't have to cast the devil out of nobody, he leaves voluntarily.
That's right. Yeah.
He can't handle the light in the life of God.
Right.
The light of God, the glory of God torments him. He runs from it.
Hallelujah.
Demons run from the blood of Jesus. Why? It's luminous. Yes. It's light. Yes. Larry Huggins wrote a book called The Blood of Jesus. I don't know what it is.
Blood speaks.
That's what it was. And he talked about that in there.
Yeah.
We're in a time right now, if we will praise God all year. Paul praised God. Paul and Silas praised Him when they were in the prison and it looked like they were going to die.
Right.
What happened? Breakthrough.
Yes.
Breakthrough and break out.
Yes.
Breakthrough in the spirit and break out of the jail.
Yes.
Jehoshaphat and Judah, they were being surrounded by the armies. They were outgunned, outmanned, outnumbered. Didn't have the natural ability to win. They went before God and petitioned Him. God says, well, I'll tell you how to handle that. Go down there where they're at. Get ready. Get ready to get into warfare. And then as you go forward, don't put the soldiers out there with the weapons. Put the choir out front. And let them lead you in spiritual warfare. And as they went forward, they praised God by saying, for the Lord is good. And His mercies are forever. What did they do? They started decreeing the covenant mercies. They started decreeing the covenant mercies. They started praising God for His covenant mercies. They started praising. And as they did that, He came down and inhabited their praises. His angels filled the spiritual atmosphere and went forth. And the demons that were on these other people trying to get them to destroy Judah, they became confused. So the people became confused. And the enemy defeated himself.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise and worship is not just being emotional. It leads to emotion. Hallelujah. It's a spiritual weapon. Think about it. When you get depressed, what's the one thing you don't want to do? Is praise.
Yep.
I had hands laid on me. I had the flu one time, had hands laid on me. As soon as my pastor touched me, every symptom left. Before I got back to my chair, they were all back. I went home, laid in my bed, felt horrible. I said, God, I've done everything I know to do.
Yeah.
according to your word. If there's something I'm missing here, I ask you to show it to me. As soon as I said that, I heard inside me the Holy Spirit quote a scripture out of Romans where it says that Abraham was strong in faith, giving glory to God. And so laying there, I'm just, you know, I feel like 100,000 miles of dead, bad road, you know? And I'm laying there, oh, Jesus, I worship you, Lord. I thank you, Father. Your word is true.
Yes.
I praise you, Lord.
Yes.
I bless you, Lord.
Yes.
I exalt you, Lord.
Yes.
I worship you, Lord. Next thing I knew, it was morning, and I was well.
Amen. That's right.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Amen.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yes.
If you will respond to every situation in praise to God, He will inhabit that situation. Because listen, if you start getting into this tit for tat deal,
right?
And I'm talking about even word, not arguing with somebody. I'm talking about what you're saying behind their back.
Yes. Come on, that's huge. Thank
God. It is. The devil's looking for a way in. Yeah, but they're just, and I understand, I'm the same way.
Yep.
Believe me, I have to repent every week.
Yep.
Don't give me the Holy Spirit. We all do. Thank God for the ministry of repentance.
Yes.
Some people teach that you don't have to repent if you're a Christian. I got news for them. You better repent. You better not align yourself. You know, even Jesus himself, and I'll close with this. Jesus himself, when he went to the cross, right before he got to the cross, when the pressure was on, remember how much pressure he had on him? In the Garden of Gethsemane, it says he was sweating blood. He was under so much emotional tension and pressure. He was sweating blood. It says that he prayed for 3 hours. And if you look the wording up, that word there about for prayer was about, it was a word about combat. He was fighting the good fight of faith right there to follow through to do what he was on this earth to do. It wasn't, you know, a walk in the park for him. And an angel came and strengthened him, it says, and helped him. But when he went to go forward, to go through this, he said to his disciples, I'm not going to talk with you much from here on. Because the prince of this world, the devil, is come. And he has no access in me.
Amen.
And so I'm not going to give him any with my mouth.
That's good.
I'm not going to start speaking things. He knew he was going to be under pressure. You know, they're interrogating him. Who was it? Pilate? Are you this and are you that? Are you the king of Israel? He goes, you said it. Amen. See, we're in a time right now where God's shifting things. Don't fall for the enemy's lies.
Amen.
If you have to have a praise party 4 times a day in your home,
yes,
if you have to go hide yourself in the broom closet at work,
yes,
instead of eating lunch, yes, and praise and magnify God. See, the Bible says, put on the garment,
yes,
of praise,
yes,
for the spirit of heaviness.
Yes.
If you'll just start being one of those wild, charismaniac Pentecostal types,
yes,
and praising and worshiping God on purpose, it will break off. The enemy will be defeated. God will inhabit that situation and he will break off of you. You can't fix spiritual problems with mental weapons. Now we are to guard our mind. We are to cast down vain imaginations. We are to renew our mind. We are to do those things with our soul. But when the enemy comes in and he's the problem, when it's the spirit of fear, it is the spirit of fear,
yeah,
not the attitude or the emotion of fear. It produces the attitude and emotion of fear.
Right.
When I was going through what I went through in 2000, the Lord started showing me this out of the Word, out of Isaiah 54, and of course, what Paul said to Timothy, he told me, what would you do if somebody broke your front door down and came in and tried to hurt you or your family? Would you just sit there and go, oh, Lord, help me, deliver us? You'd stand up and you would go after them to get them back out that door. And he said, when you feel, when you sense any edginess, any kind of thing like that in your, he said, that is the spirit of fear on the outside looking for a way in. You stand up and rebuke him in Jesus' name. You take your hands off of me in the name of Jesus. And Father, I give you praise and I give you honor that I am living under the spirit of God. Hallelujah. And as I began to do that, first it almost sounded like, you mean, really? That's it, huh?
Come on.
But when I started doing that,
yes.
it started working.
Yes.
Give no place to the devil.
Yes.
Amen. Well, this is a year of praise.
Amen.
This is a year of praise and worship and honor. This is a year where we begin to worship and praise God. Once a month in Israel, they would have their new moon feast or their new moon celebration. They would make sacrifices, and they had this choir, one choir on this side, another choir on this side, and they would do the same song thing back and forth. For the Lord is good, and His mercies endure forever. For the Lord is good, and His mercies endure forever. Once a month, God had them praise Him to remind them that He's a good God, always. His mercies endure forever. We can receive His covenant kindness. We can receive the sure mercies of David. We can receive the blessing of God. We can walk in it. Yes, there will be warfare. Yes, the enemy will do things. Yes, the enemy will target you. Yes, he'll try to trip you up. But he can't stand in the presence of God if we'll keep God in our life. Just like David setting up in the tabernacle of David, 24/7 praise for 40 years. They never lost one battle. And they were so blessed naturally. He had millions of dollars to build the temple when his son came into the kingship. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say it with me. The Lord is good.
The Lord is good.
And His mercies are forever.